shoot him in the stomach. Then he's hurting on my dime. And if I shoot him in the head, then he's dead and he's living on my mind. My reflection in the mirror, her perfection in his eyes. I'm a danger to myself, I run from 12 and take my rage across the county line.
Can you hear me? Thumbs up if you can hear me. Awesome. Thank you. Good afternoon. Thank you so much for coming to the Herbert Ortheim School of Optometry and Vision Science First Diversity, Equity, Inclusion, and Belonging Symposium. I am super excited to present this year's topic on digital health equity. We have all lived through and continue to live through the horrors of COVID-19 pandemic. Even to this day, I won't name names, but in the midst of the chaos, we are also able to witness the undoubted leaps in innovation that were able to shine through the cracks of despair. The pandemic helped to catalyze the widespread acceptance of telehealth and other digital innovations in healthcare. However, the pandemic also shined a bright light on the deep-rooted inequities that have existed in our healthcare system for centuries. With the renewed public interest in health equity, we have to ask ourselves whether advancing medical technology helps or exacerbates exclusion, introduces unexpected biases, widens the digital divide, and continues to leave some populations behind. It is therefore vital that we center equity in the digital health conversation. Digital inclusion and equity is a social determinant of health. Digital health equity represents the equitable access to digital healthcare, equitable outcomes from and experience with digital healthcare, and equity in the design of digital health solutions. The connection between our digital and physical worlds is fluid and is critical to our overall health and well-being. Access to this technology will allow providers to efficiently identify and diagnose conditions, predict outcomes, interpret imaging, prioritize patient care, disseminate timely information to communities, and improve communications between patients and other providers, allowing us to coordinate and increase the efficacy of the care rendered. Imagine a world where we can offer consultation, examination, including refraction, diagnosis, treatment, and monitoring largely from the comfort of one's home or an accessible location to one's home or work. So I want to thank the small but mighty team that helped to put this symposium together, Caitlin DeBatos and Amador Henry, my student worker Karen Villegas for designing the symposium flyer, which you see there, Eric Crapo and Lisa Shevchuk for helping with the marketing and communication, and the clinical admin team and Dean Flanagan for encouraging you to participate and adjusting the clinic schedule to accommodate the symposium. So quick thank you to the team. And I want to thank you all for being here and participating in this timely discussion. Diversity, equity, inclusion are not just catchy terms that we should throw around lightly. Our commitment to them should be at the center of our care, of our conversations, our education, and our innovations. As healthcare professionals, we have the opportunity to reaffirm and shape the future of technology in healthcare, in our research, in our clinical care, and in our policymaking. We all have the opportunity to be champions in equitable digital healthcare. So I would like to present the land acknowledgement. And first, let me stop the music that's playing in the background. Okay, so this video was provided by the American Indian Graduate Program here on campus, and I wanna thank them for providing this recorded message. As a reminder, Berkeley sits on the homelands of the Checheno-speaking Ohlone people who have been stewards of this land for over 10,000 years. We appreciate and honor the ancestors and their descendants, past, present, and future, who live and work on this land that sustains us.
UC Berkeley sits on the territory of
the Huchen, the ancestral and unceded land
of the Checheno-speaking Ohlone people,
the successors of the sovereign Verona Band of Alameda County. This land was and continues to be of great importance to the Mu'ekma Ohlone tribe and and other familial descendants of the Verona Band. We recognize that every member of the Berkeley community has and continues to benefit from the use and occupation of this land since the institution's founding in 1868.
Support local businesses owned by Native peoples.
Make a donation to the Shumi Land Tax, which directly supports Segura T's work of rematriation. We are still here.
We are still here.
We
are still here.
We are still here.
Can advance past the video. Okay. We have an impressive lineup of speakers and panelists that represent some of the leading experts in healthcare research and innovation. First, I would like to introduce our keynote speaker, Ruth Yantumbian. Ruth is a veteran of the first, another Ruth, if you can believe it. That doesn't happen often, so I have to pause and acknowledge that. Ruth is a veteran of the first wave of corporate startup innovation centers in Silicon Valley. With her deep knowledge and wide-ranging experience as an innovation expert and leader, she joined VSP Global to launch the VSP Global Innovation Center, where she leads a multidisciplinary team to scale emerging solutions into existing structures. She is recognized for her fearless ability to fuse unexpected elements into bold new work. Previously, Ruth worked as a global consultant with clients from the Bay Area to Latin America, facilitating their innovation initiatives, creating and supporting thought leadership necessary for organizations to internalize innovative opportunities, and generally combating faux innovation in its many forms, which I'll be excited to talk more about during the panel discussion. She holds a BA from the University of Southern California and holds an MBA and a master's in global management from Tulane University. She attributes her willingness to get in the trenches to her time working with small businesses in New Orleans. Please help me welcome Ruth.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Hello, everyone. How are you doing today?
All right, so I understand that this is such an important conversation that adjustments were made, mountains were moved to get you all here today. So what I wanna do before I introduce myself and we get started is to hit one myth of innovation. And that is you get things done just by running, going fast, from thing to thing. You actually need to create space for innovation. You need to create that space for serendipity. Sometimes you need to engineer it by holding that time on your calendar, making sure you show up to events like this. So I just want to start by giving an opportunity to everyone to just make some space for some new ideas that you're going to hear today, whether for myself or others on the panel. So I'm going to give you the opportunity to stand up. If you were also even thinking about moving a little bit closer, this is a way that if you want to, you have that option. And I'm just gonna let everyone take one deep eagle breath. We're in the Bay Area, we know what an eagle breath is, so. Whoop. I better hold on to this, okay. You have few more seconds if you want to take another deep breath or move closer. It's totally up to you how you want to use that 30 seconds. But that is one of the kind of myths of innovation that I find is that we think that innovation is going to happen by just staying in our tunnel and running, but we actually have to stop, make space to ingest new ideas. So think about that as you take just one more moment to create that space for yourself, is that to ingest new ideas and to be open to them, you need to have space. So I'll let you all sit down now. Hopefully that was a welcome break. So first, let me talk about the company that I work for, that I represent here today. I'm sure you're all familiar with VSP and maybe even have been more familiar with VSP for a longer time than I have. But as you all know, it's a vision care provider company. That means that we serve various companies, we call our clients, who have employees. Those are our members. and we bring them vision care benefits, making sure that individuals can reach their full potential through sight. We also support a network of doctors, I'm sure you're all familiar with that, and healthcare providers in their practices. And then there's a component of materials, we'll call it business, through Marchand of eyewear. We work with brands such as Nike and Dragon, Converse more recently, and a few others. Have a lens business as well. So it's a really complex, interesting territory for innovation. And most recently, the company has come out with a VSP Vision Impact Report. Definitely encourage you to check it out, but I think this is kind of showing the signs of the times that companies, even in vision care and healthcare, need to be thinking about their impact, because there is an inherent, like, okay, well, we're helping patients, so we're good, right? We're good. But there's actually more that's expected now of these healthcare companies when it comes to sustainability, when it comes to diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging. There's a higher expectation around CSR and our impact on people in the world. And I think that's fantastic, and I just wanted to show you this as a proof point. So I lead a team called the VSP Global Innovation Center. And as was shared about my background, I've been working in the corporate innovation space for quite a while. I went to business school, I worked with startups. I also spent some time on what we call the front lines of operations at a place like AT&T, managing technicians actually right here in Berkeley and Oakland, and really kind of understood where the rubber hit the road for that company, and then was in Silicon Valley for a number of years, partnering with startups in the space, hosting sessions where we would dialogue about the future of AI, the future of entertainment and content, drones. There's this term that tech people like to use called IoT, which means Internet of Things, where everything is connected. And we were one of the first organizations to start looking at AI and ethics, being a communications and network company. And then worked with a number of organizations and came to VSP, which was frankly a surprise to me. But once I saw the just breadth of opportunity around innovation and the way that vision impacts people's lives, it was a no-brainer that this was gonna be a really fun place to play. But I'm not gonna lie to you, innovation is not for the faint of heart. It sounds cool to try new things and to start building towards the future, but it's actually really hard because you have existing structures in place, existing behaviors and incentives. You have people who are looking at what I like to call their dashboard and living in that dashboard mentality. So if it's not part of the green, orange, red of their world, they're not. It's over here. They're not looking at it. So how does an innovation team bring the future, bring what's happening on the peripheral into the line of sight, into the dashboard, so that the large corporation feels an incentive to move and to respond? So it's quite challenging. And one thing that I attribute to what I like to call being a successful innovator, not just an innovator, is that I have respect for the past. And so as you all have moments in your career or in your life where you just want to poke holes or throw ideas over the fence, you really think about how can I come in and have respect for an organization, for leadership, for the current state, while also trying to move forward. So that's been something really helpful to me, because I found that when you stamp your feet, why aren't we doing this? Why aren't we changing? It actually undermines your credibility for the next time you want to bring forward an idea. So through my team, we've been able to bring numerous startups to our leadership, bring numerous pilots forward, because we don't stamp our feet. We share information, we build stories, we trial, we create new information, and we help the organization respond without, again, waving flags, stamping feet, which would kind of undermine our credibility. So in our team, we look at three areas right now. We kind of refresh our focus every few years. We look at health access equity, and we look at sustainability on behalf of the organization, and we look at patient experience. And so what we'll do is be the front door for various startups in the space to come through and understand where they have a fit with VSP or with our clients, members, doctors, or within our supply chain. So that's really what we're about. And we're actually going to South by Southwest next week. really exciting. And we're bringing some of our innovations forward there. So we're actually bringing 8 different startups in the vision care space under our booth. So we're essentially a platform to share with this larger innovation and technology community what's happening in vision care. Because we want those augmented reality companies, those AI companies, to focus their innovation to help our industry, to help vision care. When they could go elsewhere, we want them to focus on us. So a really great example of this that fits with our theme today is a company called Hued. I'd say if you look up one startup in this health equity space, it would be Hued. And what they do is match up patients with providers of similar background to increase their health outcomes, because they found through research that sometimes if you're Latina, let's just say, and you're going to a dermatologist who is not of your same background, they might overlook or not listen to you in a way that you should be listened to. And it's a little, you know, it's a little uncomfortable for kind of traditional health structures to hear that. So I really admire this company as just an example of innovations happening in the healthcare sector that we're now trying to see how can you help us reach those populations that might not be getting the kind of vision care they need, whether because they don't feel comfortable with the providers or they're being overlooked in some kind of way. So again, a little uncomfortable to hear, but a really interesting application of health equity and vision. So I'm gonna spend the rest of my presentation talking about general innovation and how you can bring that into your world. And then I'm going to share an example with you of our recent futurist report on healthcare deserts and closing the healthcare desert gap. But to really get the most out of the report, you'll have to download it yourself. And I'll say it is pretty fun to read. So innovation is one of those words that's lost a little bit of meaning, right? It's thrown around pretty easily. So I like to let us step back and see that the innovation is really about the ability to anticipate those disruptive forces. So how do you anticipate? Well, one, you have to create some space to do that. Many times companies create that space by having an innovation team or a lab or some kind of way to ingest and look and track those disruptive forces. And how do you do that? With practice, right? And with setting up the right mechanisms, whether that's the team, whether it's things like futurist reports that I'm about to show you, demo days, attending programs like South by Southwest or programs like this. But you can't just do it kind of riding along and crossing your fingers and hoping that you'll come upon some innovation. You anticipate through practice. And then transforming through successive incremental iterations. And what those iterations mean is that you're looking for directional feedback and you're not going at a pilot or an experiment or information just one time. You're going into it saying, we might have to ask the question 2, 3, 4 times in different ways. So since we're a small group, I thought we could do just a little exercise to really understand what successive incremental iteration is, but really what directional feedback is. So I have a number in my head, 1 to 100. And does anybody want to guess what that number is? 30. What? 50. Okay, higher. Lower. 75. Lower. 64. Higher. 67. Right. Okay. So, you're gonna get another shot. So I have another number in my head. Okay. Guesses. No. 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 All right. So now, do we feel the difference between directional feedback, right, versus not? So this is really important because many times with product development, which some of you may have access to or not, have experienced that. We go into a room, we close the door, and we just put our heads down. And then 2 years later, the world has changed, and we think that it's going to succeed in the market. And so by building in directional feedback or inputs, it helps us calibrate. So That doesn't mean that you sit there like this and wait and guess. And I'm gonna guess 50, but wait, actually, maybe I'll guess 75. I mean, of course, we go in with somewhat of an informed point of view, but then we have a bias to action, and we start trying things, and we ask questions, and then we go a little left and a little right, and so it helps get out of the world of assumptions. And I'll share a very real case of that with you. That again, this is a little uncomfortable. That's why we made that space, is around virtual exams, right? And virtual exams, you know, they can really close the gap on access. They can help with convenience, but they're, you know, really uncomfortable for many practitioners, because it could, quote unquote, take away their business. But we have to ask the question, why are people even deciding to use this technology, right? How do we get out of the assumptions and get into that directional feedback and understanding of why patients choose to use a platform like that? So, and again, clarifying what is innovation, right? We have that definition. It's really driven by changing expectations. So there's two pieces to this. There's culture, so that's the change in values, and then there's the technology component. So on our team, we look at both. We don't look at technology in a silo. So the virtual exam piece, we do landscapes of the technology and which pieces of the comprehensive exam does it cover, but without looking at that other piece of who's the patient, what are the cultural norms that are changing, the values that are changing. So if it's moving to a place like Montana, where we have more space, which is something that's happened during COVID, how does that new norm impact people's ability to get their health needs met, right? Because they're used to being 30 minutes away from their doctor, and now suddenly they're an hour and a half away. So these are important questions and pieces to ask. You can't just look at the technology piece in a silo, which is many times what's associated with innovation as technology. So I'm gonna share another example that is real and relevant, again, to the topic today. And that's the changing gender norms. So I'm sure many of us know that when you fill out a form, we're no longer just given the option of male or female. And so a large institution like VSP comes upon that question of, do we even need to offer this question up? Do we even need to ask it? And if we do, what will we do about it? What is this gonna tell us? And how do we support our practices in an unfamiliar and sometimes uncomfortable situation that they haven't had to come upon yet? And there's another question here. You know, we have different brands that we work with. I mentioned Converse earlier. So Converse is known for pink and purple shoes that men want to wear. So they don't want their pink and purple eyewear to be in the women's section. And traditionally that frame board has been split by gender, but increasingly, you'll see that that's shifting and that's changing and the companies are responding. But going back to stamping your feet, you have to guide people through that journey. So my team actually led a forum where we brought different companies who've gone through that journey together. We brought in some startups that are enabling that to help our leaders understand and not just respond. Okay, let's add one more box to the form. Let's get rid of the frames without supporting practices through that journey. So that's like a very real kind of relevant current example of where culture is also a piece of innovation. So here are a few reasons why companies innovate. So amplifying insights and explorations. I kind of categorize this as promotion, but I just want to share it because there is value in dialogue. And so sometimes, as I talk about faux innovation and fake innovation, there's hackathons and events, and it can just be sort of shiny and fluffy and not really go anywhere. But there is an important step to innovation, and that is the dialogue piece. Everything starts from a conversation. And so if a company is engaging in innovation to be that platform, to host that dialogue, to bring different perspectives together, there is value in that. And so as you look at different innovation initiatives, sometimes it might just be under this category of creating dialogue and promoting information. Adoption, so that's really changing the way we do work, our approaches, For example, you may have heard of human-centered design. That's an example of adopting a new way of working. Education, first step, again, just along with promotion, you gotta first educate the people who are executing. So if you expect practitioners to just go and change their frame board without providing the context, there's a miss there. So a lot of what our team does actually is elevate the understanding of these different areas to employees, partners, and also our customers and clients. So sustainability is an area that is rather new, again, to the vision care industry, and we spend a lot of time on education there. R&D, that's really informing the development of new solutions. Biz dev is looking at existing solutions and engaging partners to get that done. So that's really leapfrogging your technology, leapfrogging your products through either acquisition or partnerships. So this is one of the more popular ways that these different innovation centers work in Silicon Valley in particular. That's how we did it at AT&T. And this is something that I've been working at bringing into VSP, is how do you partner with companies to bring in solutions rather than building it in-house. And then sales. So that's really about monetizing solutions and building client relationships. So a pass-through, say acquiring new practice software and then handing off that solution to the doctors in your network, for example. So a few other myths to bust. Innovation is not about being right. It's about learning and catalyzing. Sometimes we think, oh, an innovator can look into their crystal ball and know what's coming next. But being a good innovator, again, is really about learning and then catalyzing the next step. So when you think about your own world and your own work, how can you get the most learnings out of a project, out of an experience, out of your time on the ground? Let's say you're shadowing another practice or doctor or someone in a completely different industry. Focus on the learning rather than on being right. Many times our egos get in the way of really learning and ultimately taking work a step further. And to be the tip of the spear, so that means going first, right? When you're the tip of the spear, you go first. You need to be sharp. So that means, you know, practicing, putting yourself in those places to be aware, to respond, and to have the most current information. Okay, so now that we got through a bit of innovation or corporate innovation 101, I want to talk about one of the resources that our team puts out for both the industry and for our own organization. And they're called the Futurist Report Series. So this is all available on the website in the VSP Innovation site. We have produced about 5 of these. And they're really that storytelling piece of innovation. So the context. If we were to just say, you got to work with HUD, the company I mentioned earlier, without the context and the landscape, the story would be lost. Without the insights, we wouldn't be able to understand what are the indicators that this is a groundswell, there's a groundswell of innovation here. So some of the indicators that we look at are investment in emerging technologies. Easy to say here in Silicon Valley, kind of a little bit of the air we breathe, but in many other places or environments, or even here, there's a lack of awareness of looking at this venture funding as a source of information, but it's basically an indicator of there's energy, there's time, there's investment, and there's resources. So likely something's gonna happen in this space. Likely there's interest, likely there's patients or customers or clients in this space. So we focus on that. We look at partnerships. We look at market data. And we try and understand what are the major themes taking place in a space. So I'll just kind of touch on one of these before I go in a little bit deeper into healthcare deserts. So this is one of my favorites. It's the future of personal performance. And this is really all about the ways in which we're biohacking, focused on the quantified self. We're augmenting our bodies with robotics, tools, different measurements. And so one of the companies that we met through this process of putting together the report. It was called Synaptic. And so they worked with athletes to look at more than just their eye health and more than just whether or not they need a improved prescription, but how their peripheral vision was, how their spatial memory was, and then train so that if you're at 90% as an athlete and you just need that 10% advantage, you could train your eye to go a little bit further. So we did a pilot with them about a year ago and worked with various athletes to understand, does this really make a difference? Could this be applied to a patient coming in, to their kids who are playing sports? And does this also create more appreciation for vision? You know, because we don't think about the transactional nature on the other side, on the patient side. Just, okay, just give me my contact lenses, just give me my eyewear. And so once you start to realize, oh, wow, my lower left peripheral vision needs some work, you're more aware and more appreciative and kind of stickier in our vision care ecosystem. So our latest report has been on the future of healthcare desert solutions. So we looked at, first of all, what's a healthcare desert? So this is an area of a geographic area with limited access to care and key services. So there's a few different types. There's hospital healthcare deserts, there's primary care deserts, there's eye care deserts, there are even pharmacy deserts. So this is an important context for some of the burgeoning, growing areas of healthcare. I'm sure you've all seen the kind of Uber for prescriptions, where they'll come to your house, right, and versus you having to go into a Walgreens or CVS. So this is sort of the category that we're looking at here, is where are the deserts and how does technology and innovation fill the gap? But then also, why does this topic matter right now? Because with the movement of people, with the lack of access, you have different health outcomes. And so can vision care, is one of the questions that we're asking now, be a stopgap or help fill that gap for other healthcare deserts through vision care? As you all know, you can determine other health outcomes around diabetes and hypertension through the eye. So that's why we're looking at this. In this report, again, you all have access to this, this is online. We have a few important numbers of indicators of where the innovation is going in healthcare deserts. So 80% of counties in the US have at least one type of healthcare deserts. So that's one third of the population here. 60 of these counties have multiple types of care deserts. But on the upside, while venture funding has generally gone down in most sectors, last year was a record year for funding of technologies scaling access. So really interesting, a lot of what's in this report kind of attributes that to solutions for COVID, when we were all socially distanced or not going into spaces, are now being repurposed around access. So how do we give health access when you can't be there in person? So COVID was a big driver in shifting the focus from how can we fill in during a period of COVID, now how can we reapply that technology to this health access, healthcare desert world. I kind of shared a little bit about this, navigating the report. Innovation, again, is many times storytelling and looking at those indicators so that it's not just, I have an idea. It's, well, here's the story, here's the context, and here's some solutions that show that this is coming into the world. So we looked in this report at four different areas of insights. One is patient to care, so how integrated systems are lowering barrier to access in practice care. So that's more about the doctor out, patient in model, which some practices look at. The care to patient, so I was just saying, the rise of direct-to-consumer tools that came up during COVID, now helping patients reach care across time and space. In-store innovations, that's very much about how retailers, some unsuspecting ones, which I'll go through in a bit, are using different hardware platforms or health kiosks to be a sandbox for future care centers. So companies like Target and Walmart are seeing themselves as healthcare companies, not just retailers. And then software is really supercharging on-ramps to care within deserts. So finding that maybe you're taking a virtual exam at home, but it's actually inevitably to bring you back into an environment where you can see a doctor one-on-one. So as I said, patient to care, this patient in, doctor out model, there's a rising set of players in the space. I'll just talk about one trend that we found was really around transportation and that last mile being a focus for a number of companies. There's a startup called Kaizen that does this and coordinates travel into different practices. And so they will help people who maybe have multiple children or a hard time getting out of their job with very limited ability to go in and help them get that transportation. Companies like Lyft, Lyft Healthcare looks at non-emergency transportation. So if I were to highlight one shift and insight that's taking place from patient to care, getting the patient to the care, it's really new players coming into transportation and focusing on that last mile. And then with care to patient, so this is the one, again, using direct-to-consumer and shifting it from COVID to now access, is there are a lot of at-home tests. So you may have heard of Viome. You may have heard of Everly Health. So that's really about how can we minimize the time you might need to come in or give you the ability to do some kind of screening or test so you're coming into the practice with more information. One company that is really interesting I would keep your eye on if you haven't already seen them, I think they're in the marina here, is Forward Health. And so they do a hybrid of, and then they're a subscription service. So they have a hybrid of sending someone to your house to get your blood drawn, then you have a kind of full holistic virtual discussion with a doctor who goes over your results, and then you can go into their space and they have a bunch of technology that you can use to test all kinds of, more than just your weight, but all kinds of different components of your health. And I'm pretty sure that soon we might be seeing a vision exam in there. So I'm keeping my eyes on it. In-store innovation, so that's really that self-assessment piece. There are a number of players here like Higi and OnMed, and they're placing these self-service health kiosks and then beaming in doctors or others, or even fulfilling prescriptions on the spot. So while this has been a space and a technology that's been around for quite a while, I mean, probably 15 or so years, there is a resurgence, and there's different big box retailers like the Dollar General or Family Dollar, Target. They're creating partnerships rather than trying to create their own in-house healthcare services. They're bringing in these kiosks or they're partnering with outside groups. And then lastly, software. I think we may not be aware that there are many practices struggling with staffing and they have limited hours. And so I think there's a appetite now for some software solutions to help increase the provider bandwidth in the face of labor shortages. So again, no longer, well, you know, the chart's up on the piece of paper on the door and I'll cross my fingers and hope we can serve all of our patients, but there's new services being brought in. We looked at a company that helps with text messaging to patients so that you're more aware of when they're running late or need a change in their schedule and how that actually creates some efficiencies in the office rather than phone calls pulling different people away or reps away from the work that needs to be done or technicians. So if you were to have three takeaways, the access innovation and adoption, it really accelerated during the pandemic. So there's a more robust ecosystem of healthcare desert solutions. There was a bit more tolerance from the industry to understand how do we connect back to patients in this virtual world. And then that just, I think, has opened the door to more funding and more interest. And then of course, we cover that four key categories of emerging eye care solutions that are available or in development. And I think if you're following the FDA approvals, they're definitely increasing. I know I was just talking to an entrepreneur who's here earlier, who their company just received FDA approval. And then changes in patient perspective and values. So in combination with regulatory incentives, the patient behaviors and what they want out of their healthcare experience is really changing. And so the at-home test is a great example of that. The convenience, the virtual care, you know, not for every patient, right? Because there's still some individuals who want to be in person and maybe, you know, have other needs, but there is generally a growth in some of these spaces because of changing values on the patient side. So I hope you check out the report. It has a lot of great information about healthcare desert solutions. As I said, we have other reports that we've produced in the past. One was called Eye on the Metaverse, another about health and wellness, another about omnichannel, and I mentioned the performance vision. And so as an innovator in this space, I think there's a lot of potential here. And whether you're in an environment where you're in a full-time job or you're a student, I definitely encourage you to come into these places looking at the current state with a lot of respect and understanding why things are the way they are. But you have my permission to have what we call a day one mindset through your journey as for as many years as you're in working in this industry. A day one mindset is saying, I'm going to look at this problem, I'm going to look at this space as if it's the first time or the first day that I've looked at it, rather than letting myself be entrenched by all the yeses and nos that I've experienced here. So we'll end it on that. And I hope we have a great conversation coming up, and I hope you stick around for that. Thanks.
We're going to take a quick stretch break just so I can get the panelists up and mic'd. So quick stretch break, grab some snacks in the back. Sorry, one more time, round of applause for our keynote speaker. Thank you. Now a quick stretch break, and we'll get going in probably about 3 to 4 minutes. So don't go too far. And remember, I am feeding you at the end of this too, so incentive to stick around. All right.
together.
And now I'd like to introduce you to our panelists who will discuss their work at the forefront of healthcare and technology, specifically addressing the challenges and opportunities that technology has in the eye care landscape. First up, I would like to invite Dr. Jorge Cuadros. Oh, there you are. He is a professor and the director of informatics research at the University of California in Berkeley Optometric Eye Care Center. He's also the founder of IPACS, a program used for detecting diabetic eye disease and other conditions that have been used in over 1,000 community health centers and cited by over 650 scientific publications. That's a great goal to reach. He started his first telemedicine eye care program in 1993, worked with Berkeley and others to develop a sustainable telemedicine platform based on open source and open access informatic principles. And he's conducted clinical trials on several innovative technologies such as automated retinal image reading, laser imaging devices, and primary care programs. His work is focused on expanding access to eye care in underserved communities. So he's basically my Berkeley spirit animal, Dr. Cuadros.
It's great to be here. You guys are my family, essentially, my Berkeley family. And so for that reason, it would be great if you can really think about, you know, how, you know, questions that you have as far as your future career. I see a lot of students here, a lot of people that have their whole careers in front of them, or at least a big part of it. And so, you know, there's going to be so many changes. And not only is it cool to know what's happening and as far as innovations, but it'd be great to have a discussion with you as far as what's going to happen. You know, what are you going to do? I know some of the older optometrists always get a little nervous about that. So please, you know, if you have questions, please, I think we're going to have a good session. And, you know, really having a discussion is the most important thing, mostly because we're all Berkeley folks here. And this is a problem that we have to solve, a problem that hasn't been clearly elucidated as to what the future is going to bring. I think, you know, this is like that Charles Dickens movie. I think I'm the voice of the past, maybe, because I've been around for so long. And I can tell you a little bit about my own little journey through this in these few minutes. It was really driven by two things. You know, I was always kind of interested in computer stuff and information technology. In fact, when I was an undergrad at UCLA, I told my dad, oh, this is what I want to go into. And he goes, go into optometry. And so I did, and I don't regret it. And, you know, the interest was always there. So I liked doing that part of it, the programming and all that. The other thing is when I became an optometrist, I worked in a predominantly Spanish-speaking community. Actually, it was a community that really lacked access. And as Ruth was saying, it was really a healthcare desert, even though sometimes it seemed like a jungle, because there was all kinds of weird things going on there, and you know, maybe a little bit of a predatory environment, difficult to navigate. And so when I thought about telemedicine, I wasn't even thinking about telemedicine. I was thinking about how can I get my patients into care. You know, these were a lot of patients that I would see as an optometrist back in the early 90s when optometrists couldn't do anything. We could barely dilate pupils. And so, you know, I would refer them. They wouldn't be able to go, you know, for any kind of secondary care. And so I was thinking, okay, well, telemedicine could, well, wasn't even called telemedicine back then, but, you know, something where I could communicate, maybe I could have a little more hands-on with my patients. And little did I know that it was going to become what it is today. Back then, however, once I got started in this, I thought, oh my God, this is going to be a big thing. And everybody was talking about how huge this is going to be. By the year 2000, most of healthcare is going to be done by telemedicine. And, you know, obviously that didn't happen. In fact, I did go through some informatics classes, and people were saying, oh, well, we won't need doctors anymore. And that was in the 1970s. you know, there was artificial intelligence back then that was better than humans for selecting the type of antibiotic that you know should be prescribed. There was this great program called ELISA, which people were saying, oh my God, this is better than a psychologist. And all it really did was just reflect back what people were saying. That was the 1970s, right? Same thing happened again in the 90s. And I think we're also going through now a resurgence of interest in artificial intelligence, in these innovations. And, you know, we just have to keep it in context in the past. You know, we still don't have cars that fly along the roads. In fact, we barely have self-driving cars. I mean, we don't see that much on the freeway. So there's a way to go. And really, I think in the end, when we're adopting innovations, there's some innovations that are really simple to adopt, like OCT has just exploded because those innovations are easy for us to digest in our professional life. Other innovations like remote eye exams, a little harder. And there's a process of bringing that into your life. It was expressed by a professor over at Stanford and Terry Winograd and Fernando Flores, who was from Chile. And they talked about this structural coupling idea. And that is that you have an innovation, and then you put it out there in the world, and you expect, and the engineers and people that develop it and the people who are in the sandbox doing it are saying, oh man, this is great, this is gonna change everything. But what ends up happening is that all of society kind of has to change and adapt. There's so many different things, the workflows, the attitudes, the human part of how you do it, that really affects how the innovations end up, you know, developing in a lot of times in really unexpected ways. So just as an example, we had this experience with Google, you know, with the diabetic retinal screening programs. Well, you know, by that time, this was 2016, it was pretty clear that algorithms were much better than humans at detecting diabetic retinopathy from retinal images. And so, you know, Google being who they are, they say, oh, this is gonna be great, we'll just put it out there and, you know, done. We solved the problem of blindness from diabetes. And so, I don't know, I mean, they used some of our data, and we can definitely have a conversation about whose data is it really, and who should benefit from the use of the data that, for example, that we supplied to Google to develop their algorithms, definitely a worthwhile conversation. But the whole point with Google was that we said, well, so what? So what? You have an algorithm that does all, you know, that's that accurate. How are you gonna put it into real life? And they said, oh, well, what do you mean? I said, well, just having like something that says red light, refer, green light, don't refer, does nothing for the patient. You know, you have to engage a patient into their care. You have to communicate, and that should actually dictate how they develop their algorithms. To their credit, they funded a study with us. So we looked at, well, what is the compliance with referrals? Something that I was working on since 1990s, right? Extremely low. Did you guys know that? And for those clinicians that are in clinic, did you know that probably most of the referrals that you make to specialists are never done, especially when you're talking about patients with low access to care? Patients in the safety net. Most of the time you're writing a referral and they don't go. That's probably a bigger problem, I would say, than having some automation. Oh, we can grade retinas now. There's no shortage. You know, I never felt like there was really a shortage of eye care providers to look at images. But where the innovation really is helpful is in providing an immediate diagnosis. Only if you change the healthcare system around it so that you can take advantage of that immediate diagnosis. Same thing happened with electronic medical records. my mentor over at UCSF, she did a little study on electronic medical records and found that 8% of the investment was in the actual technology of the EMR. And then the vast majority of the investment was in getting your whole organization and the whole system to be able to accommodate the EMR. And we're still battling with that now, 20 years later. So anyway, I hope that, you know, that's spurred some, how many minutes?
You're up.
Okay, spurred some questions, and I'd love to have a conversation about this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Quadras. Nope, you stay right there. All right, now I'd like to invite Dr. Ninju Manivanan to the stage. She is the head of algorithm development and clinical research at Carl Zeiss Meditech. Her team is responsible for developing clinical applications for ophthalmic imaging technologies and for developing algorithmic solutions for OCT, fundus and function testing modalities. She completed her undergrad at College of Engineering Gwindi and her PhD in electrical and computer engineering at The Ohio State University. She has a background in radiology and developing AI solutions for ophthalmic diagnostics. Please come on up. Share a few words.
Yes. I have to keep it 5 minutes. Hey everyone, I'm gonna move away from because they always make me feel short. Drive your heels so Niranchana, because you can't find me in LinkedIn, try with my last name. You might be able to find it. Mint and the program, you will be using the devices. When I looks at me like a boogeyman, they are like, okay, are you going to take my job away? No, I am here to tell you that your job is secure more than ever. The AI is not going to replace doctors. It's mainly going to augment what doctors are doing in some places. So in future, it's going to be doctors with AI and doctors without AI. It's about doctors with AI can provide, you know, better care access when you're not using the AI solution. Like, that's the kind of AI the team develops. Because this is the first question I'm asked, like, whenever I go, oh, what does the AI do? So it's not a black, you know, even though it's a black box technology, what it does is something very clear. It's about actually improving the access in the end of the day. Because when you work in an area like artificial intelligence, like deep learning, which uses convolutional neural networks, don't worry about all these words. The only thing you need to know is they use a lot of data. So all the solutions is developed by using the data. When you rely on technologies that is very data heavy, you need to be very cognizant about what the data represents. Because the data has bias. It's about the historical bias in the access to the healthcare. It's about the historical bias in the lack of diversity, and also about the bias in about the equity. It's all there in the data. We cannot leave all the old data, because the old data is really going to help us also move faster. So we have to be cognizant of the biases. I always see it as, you know, it's like your blind spot when you're driving. You need to know it's there. You need to make sure that, you know, you're doing everything to reduce the risks. So when we do algorithm development, we think about, you know, diversity of the data day in and day out. How do we make sure that we get in all diverse population data in there? Diversity is not only ethnicity and population. It's about getting different age groups. It's about getting data from people who live in different geographical location, from outside US, from India, from Africa, from Southeast Asia Pacific. So diversity is about, you know, our equal representations of sometimes like genders. So it's different aspects of the diversity which we look in data. When you actually look for that particular type of data, that's when the access and then the equity and then lack thereof in the history is going to hit you in the face, because you'll be looking for certain data for one of our projects, maybe from southern part of India, and then you wouldn't have it because that's not the type of treatment which has been provided there for some time. So, you know, that's all you have to keep in mind when you develop a solution for clinical utility. So that's one, part of my team's work. The other part of the team is clinical research team. I think that might be close to you. Even though I'm standing here talking about diversity, most of my team is actually Berkeley ODs. We also have other ODs, but you know, because Zias is in Dublin Pleasanton, it's very close. We always get, you know, a lot of Berkeley ODs. All of them are doing clinical research there. So what they do in day-to-day life is they provide clinical insights, because like how Ruth was saying, we go into a room, develop something, and after 2 years, everything changes. So to keep more agile mentality, we have these doctors in our team who provide feedback every day. So we ask them, oh, how does this work? Is this going to be really useful in clinic? Because we don't want to, you know, develop something which has no connection to your clinical workflow. So these doctors will give, you know, insights and then feedback about whatever we are developing in the innovation process. And they are also working in developing clinical evidence. What I mean by developing clinical evidence is, when you develop a clinical utility tool, like how I was mentioning, like an AI solution, those tools need to be proved that it's working for registration with FDA and other regulatory bodies. For that, we need data collection. So this group of ODs and research scientists and also MDs, they develop clinical studies, and then they make sure that the clinical study is done in a diverse population. Also in different geography locations, to make sure that we can claim the product is working similarly in all the areas. So because of like the specific kind of work I do, the DEI has always been, you know, a day-to-day activity for us. When we look at the data, when we look at the solution, I'm looking forward to actually talk more with many of you, and also with the panel. I'll also be hanging around after. You can just flag me and ask me more questions. Thank you.
Okay, next up, I'm gonna invite Dr. Corey, I combined the two words. Dr. Corey Hakkanen, who is an optometrist and product manager who specializes in eye care and optical product development. He received his OD from Berkeley School of Optometry and his MBA from San Jose State University. After working as a clinical optometrist in retail and private practice, he made a pivot into an industry career in product management, where he draws on his skills as an OD to influence the development of new eye care products and services in the technology industry. He has worked in industry roles for companies such as LensCrafters, Zenni, and 2020 Therapeutics, and currently works as Meta as a product manager. Please come on up.
Sure. Hi, everybody. This is more like a reunion for me than a panel speaking opportunity. I know so many people here. This is what Ruth read, so I'm going to skip it. But I often get the question of, what do I do and how did I get to what I'm doing? So I think that's probably good context to set for the panel today. So like Ruth mentioned, I'm a product manager. I am an optometrist. I'm a class of Berkeley 2014, Go Bears. But for the last 6 years, I've been a PM, or product manager. And what that means is I manage a line of products. So let's say somebody at CooperVision, who's a product manager, maybe they are the line manager for the Biofinity lens set. And so they would come up with the strategy and the plan for like the next Biofinity coming out. So like, what's the price? What are the parameters? What's the base curves it's gonna be offered in? When is it gonna launch? Is there gonna be an iteration for the next gen? And then maybe making iterations on the things in the market. So it's very interesting and fun. But I think I'll just touch briefly on how did I get to doing that. After Berkeley, I went to work for Lens Crafters, which, as you know, is a megalithic empire under EssilorLuxottica. And in that paradigm, I was able to do some business opportunities. So I went from being a clinical practitioner to spending about half of my time doing regional management. And so that got me interested in the business side of eye care. So I was teaching doctors, mentoring staff, helping them set their clinical and business metrics. And that got me really interested in doing product development because I was seeing that a lot of the things that companies are pushing out maybe weren't that impressive or were not hitting the needs of current patients in the market. So I tried for a while to just make a cold switch into product management for healthcare companies, and I was very unsuccessful at doing that for a while. So to give myself a better chance at that, I went back to school again and then got my MBA nearby. And since then, I've been a product manager for a number of years now. I was at Zenni for a number of years, which I'll talk about in a moment. I moved over to 2020 Therapeutics, which is a little kernel under the Google umbrella, and then currently I'm a product manager at Meta. So I'll talk for a moment about Zenni. I was there for a few years as a product manager. Here's a picture of me and my team and some of the Berkeley interns that we had at that time. And so what I really appreciated about Zenni and product management there is it has a very accessibility-first focused. So the company's slogan is eyewear for everyone, and they really mean it. They do that in two different ways. One of the ways is by price. So you can get a complete pair of glasses for like 10 bucks and up. And so that's one way to increase access to folks by making it affordable for people that can't afford expensive products otherwise. And the other was just in terms of product selection, which is more what my team had control over. So making sure we had frames for people with a low nose bridge or a wide face or a petite face or, you know, little kids who are rough and tumble. And then also lenses for all types of needs. So rolling out a suite of blue blocker lenses, not only in a clear lens, but getting a blue blocker in a sunglass or a photochromic or a Trivex impact resistant for kids. So that was a really meaningful portion of my life. And it was a very good way to give back in terms of accessibility. And then for the last few years at my time between 2020 and Meta, I can't talk about specifically what I've been doing because they're unreleased products, but generally it's either been thinking of the tools you use in clinic on an everyday basis and giving it like either a connected or a smart twist to it that's next generation or consumer electronics. So that's my career in a nutshell. I'm excited to talk to you guys about accessibility and thank you for having me.
Last but certainly not least, I'd like to have Dr. Faiz Magoub come up. He's an optometrist with a passion for technology and eye care. He's the founder of Augmented Vision Labs, a technology company that is dedicated to utilizing emerging technologies to solve persistent problems in eye care. He enjoys giving back to the optometric community and currently serves as treasurer of the National Optometric Association, as well as the academic and diplomatic liaison for the Intrepid Eye Society. He also founded Young Leaders in Optometry, a professional leadership organization whose goal is to identify the brightest young minds in optometry and empower them to reach their full potential. Come on up, Dr. Magoub.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks so much for having us. And I'm excited to share with you a little bit about the work that I've been doing since I graduated from optometry school, which was in 2018. I went to Western, so one of the three Cali schools. I actually had the pleasure of being able to come to this school in February of 2020. Shortly after I got home, the world changed quite a bit, so it's nice to be back again here at Berkeley. So as Dr. Shoghi mentioned, I'm the founder of Augmented Vision Labs, and it's a company that I started because I saw that there were persistent problems in eye care that weren't being addressed, and I saw a unique potential to apply emerging technologies to these problems. And we have two areas of focus, the first being scleral lens insertion, and the second being anterior segment imaging. So with scleral lens insertion, I'm not sure if y'all are familiar with what the literature says on this. About 10% of scleral lens patients actually drop out of lens wear within the first year. And these are patients who are prescribed these lenses for a medically necessary reason. So they're not just cosmetic lenses that they want to wear instead of wearing glasses. They're lenses that they actually need to be able to function and see their best. And the reason for this 10% dropout is due to lens handling issues. And lens handling essentially is lens insertion and removal, with the vast majority of patients having more difficulty with inserting the lenses. There are several contributing factors that cause this issue. For a lot of patients, they have a strong blink reflex, and they're not able to just hold their lids open. There are patients who have dexterity issues. Some of those are pathological, secondary to a stroke, arthritis, Parkinson's, or some other condition affecting their dexterity. And another issue complicating the process is the fact that the lens is clear and it's filled with a clear fluid, and the patient has visual impairment, so they're not able to see the lens well, and they often misalign their eye to the lens and they end up tipping the lens over, fluid spills out, you get air bubbles, or you can't even get the lens in the eye. You know, some patients have multiple of these issues that they're contending with, and so it makes it a really frustrating and difficult process. So patients who are within that group who don't, you know, naturally get better through training are faced with a dilemma. They can continue suffering with having issues with inserting their lenses and relegating themselves to spending an hour or more every morning just to put their lenses in. I've had a patient tell me that he spent 6 hours one day putting his lenses in. So, you know, you understand that if you're faced with that situation of not being able to drive, not being able to go to work because you can't see, and you need to be able to get this lens in your eye, you know, it's a pretty difficult situation. Some patients decide to give up on lens wear and relegate themselves to having worse vision in glasses because they just can't seem to get the lenses in, so they just don't see it as an option. And some patients opt for a corneal transplant, which in some cases can help you get better vision than without correction at all. But for a lot of the patients who get a corneal transplant, to be able to get to see the best vision possible, they actually need a specialty lens. So they're kind of back to square one to needing an RGP or a scleral lens. So I came face to face with this issue when I was a fourth year extern working at a specialty contact lens clinic, and I got the pleasure of doing all the insertion removal training. So when it was 7 p.m. on a Friday when there was nobody in the building, it was me and a patient working on getting their lenses in because they knew that if they could not insert them and remove them there in the clinic, they can't take them home. And so, you know, these patients that are near and dear to my heart. They're very motivated, and you know, we're kind of the last line of defense for them before they have to face some of these less than ideal options. So the solution that we've arrived at is a two-part solution. One is a physical product that assists patients with inserting their lenses. We call it the S5 lens insertion system. And the second component is a virtual service that we offer to patients, which is unlimited lens insertion coaching that we make available 7 days a week. And the S5 lens insertion system consists of two devices, the S5 inserter, which is optimized for lens insertion while standing, and the S5 mini, which is optimized for insertion while seated. And I have a video here illustrating how they both work. No problem. Sorry about the technical issues. So I guess I'll maybe just go back to this slide and illustrate. So as you see in the middle picture there, there is a light in the middle of the device, and the device allows the patient to actually use two hands to hold their lids open, and the patient doesn't actually have to hold the lens either with a tripod method or with a plunger. So if they have a tremor or an issue with dexterity, they're not having to stabilize the lens, and they're not having to use one hand to hold the lens and open their eyelids, so that eliminates some of those issues. And the light in the middle of the lens there is a target to guide the patient. So even if they have a visual impairment, they don't have to actually see the boundaries of the lens, they can just focus on the light. And so those three benefits end up solving the vast majority of issues that patients have. And we've been fortunate to partner with a lot of independent practices, schools, and institutions to make the devices available for patients to trial in clinic, as well as partnering on doing research like at Southern College of Optometry, where we validated the efficacy of the device. Anterior segment imaging is the other area that we focused on, and I personally believe that this modality is widely underutilized, and has great potential for us to not only enhance patient management and outcomes, but also to enhance clinician training and also patient education. There are several reasons why it's not as widespread as it should be. Part of that is cost, and part of it is also the lack of interoperability. So some of the companies that are producing imaging systems, those systems are not compatible with all the slit lamps out there. So it's a logistical issue as well as a cost issue. And the approach that we've taken is a two-part approach where we've developed a system called the Isla system that incorporates an iPhone or an iPad that can be connected to a slit lamp. And we've teamed that with a custom manufacturing process that allows us to actually take measurements of the slit lamp that you have and then custom make an adapter that works for that slit lamp. So it helps us sidestep the compatibility issues. And this is what it looks like. This is an iPhone connected to a slit lamp using the Isla. And some demo photos here. And these were all taken with an iPhone 6S. So yeah, you can see that, you know, technology has come a long way and we still haven't integrated, you know, the earlier versions of it. So that's also part of the reason to address the cost issue, because if you already have a phone that is, you know, not being used, you can upcycle it and put it to good use and get great images out of it. And I'm gonna show you a video here. Oh, the videos don't work, I don't think. Well, maybe this one will work. Might be hard to see with the lighting, but this is. This is a video of a spontaneous hyphema that a friend of mine, Dr. Mark Schaefer, took. And so having a video like this to share with a specialist or to share with a patient of, hey, this is why your eye is red. We think there is something systemic going on, and this is why we're referring you to get more testing done. So thank you very much.
Thank you. And I will invite Ruth back up on stage to round out our group of panelists. Okay, so thank you everyone for, one, introducing yourselves, because I didn't want to just jump into a panel discussion and you all not really have any idea who these people are. So you at least now understand kind of the modality, what they do, what they've been working on, from our self-described ghost of tech past, but with always a vision on the future, though. So that's amazing. To someone who identified something as a fourth-year student, identified a problem and came up with a solution for that. So I think, I hope you think that makes for a very well-rounded panel discussion. All right, so I'm going to start with one question first, and what issues are most important to you when you think about diversity, equity, inclusion? Thinking about diversity, of course, in the broadest terms, but what are the most important issues to you? And anybody is free to jump in to answer that question.
If I may start, because of the work which I do, for me, the diversity, when I first think about it, like the thing which comes to me is data. Because the data is shaping some of the technologies which we are developing. Data is the new oil. It's going to be the new future. And when we are leveraging the data, I always want us to keep in mind about the bias. I think that's something which, you know, that the diversity kind of brings to mind. For me also, if I extend it, diversity is not only a single dimensional problem like data, you know, that's when the access and the other things come into play. It's also about like bringing different people with different backgrounds into the table. It's about having the doctors, you know, who's working as the product manager to help in developing something. It's also about having a technician, because the technician will be doing so many work. So then the all part of the innovation is also an aspect of diversity which I'm looking at.
Thank you. One thing I want to say before I have someone else answer. This is intended to also be a conversation. So please, if you have questions, I don't want you to feel like you have to hold on to it for the next 40 minutes. We have Caitlin in the back with a microphone. So if you have a question, please raise your hand. We'll run the mic over to you. And we're gonna plan to, this is Caitlin, so that you all see who she is. Thank you.
Especially if you disagree, it'd be great to say, I disagree with that statement, and then you, yeah,
yes.
then we'll have a good conversation.
I'll kind of add some things. So I think, you know, typically consolidation is seen as a bad thing. And I think in this industry, just coming in as an outsider, I've definitely witnessed the tone of that conversation being negative. But I actually think it's to our detriment that we're not having a holistic view of what's happening on the patient side, because when you do have data that you can clean and make sure it's not biased, then you also can capture the reality of a situation. And because we're so fragmented, and there are some good things about that, right? Sometimes I think being able to own your own practice and own your own future is fantastic, but because we don't have enough ways to see what's holistically going on in the industry, it allows us to either turn away from problems or not have the actual data around problems, whether that's health intended diversity, what patients want out of their healthcare experience. So this is one way in which I think fragmentation is actually opposed to diversity and bias. So.
Is really important, and I think that the clinician's voice isn't always represented in some of these projects that you hear about, which is great, you know, to see, you know, Corey involved, you know, with one of the big companies who have the resources to really make a big impact. And I think for us as optometrists, you know, we have to look for those tables and then try to get a seat at the table, because we're always advocating for the patient, and we're also advocating for the profession of optometry. So we have a responsibility to see that, you know, if a new innovation does come about, that it's not hurting optometry and that it's not hurting our patients.
I think something that I'm passionate about is making sure that we can bring to the table people being able to step into someone else's shoes and understand their situation and provide empathy for that. One personal example is that I got married recently. I have a same-sex partner and my husband, and I got married a few months ago. I didn't always know that I wanted that. And so it's interesting having like a part of my life where I didn't know that and then I did. So now I can step into like TV shows or movies or certain contexts and be like, oh, like that lands with me different now than maybe it did 10, 15 years ago. So I'm very passionate about technology or conversations or media that helps people understand another person's perspective.
And just to round it out, you know, the big question that comes up when we're talking to clinics, organizations, health systems that are offering up their data to develop AI or to develop anything, a new instrument, is how will this help that clinic? You know, and a lot of times, you know, oh, no, you're going to be a customer just like everybody else, and that just doesn't fly. So I think that's one of the big issues of what we need to do with innovation, is consider who it's going to benefit. I guess that's an obvious thing.
And there are a lot of ways it can be beneficial, which is why I think I asked about thinking about diversity in a broad way. You know, I know a lot of times the conversation inappropriately circles around race, ethnicity, because we see the big disparities there, but considering gender identity and the disparities there, and physical inability, psychological inability, and all the different ways in which we can use technology to address healthcare inequities based on the different groups. And so, Fai, as you mentioned, optometry having a seat at the table, which I think is why I wanted to kind of start the DEIB symposium with this topic, because I'm wondering how many of us think about the intersection of tech and healthcare outside of just our day-to-day, you know, EMR system and the OCT and the visual field. How else should we be innovating in this profession to meet the needs of patients, especially in an equitable fashion? So how do you think we should leverage creativity and emerging technology to address inequity in healthcare?
I can jump in and share a few
question.
Thoughts.
Come on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think that there are two ways, two parallel paths. One, we can innovate within the eye care ecosystem, and then one would be us reaching outside the eye care ecosystem. So for example, you know, we don't have computer science degrees or product design degrees. There are companies who, you know, recruit those professionals to work on projects that affect the visual system, but we're just not involved in that loop. So talking about augmented and virtual reality, those could be tools that we can appropriate into the eye care ecosystem to help our patients to be able to do diagnostic and treatment modalities. And since we don't have that within our realm of experience, we have to kind of venture out of our eye care ecosystem and engage with those folks. And then alternatively, we have companies that are innovating for us. So you have, you know, when you go into clinic, you see all the instruments that are there. Those are companies that are innovating specifically for eye care, and we can engage those companies and work within them. So I think part of it is working more diligently in our own space, and part of it is going outside our comfort zone and building bridges.
So for me, like seeing this panel itself, I'm seeing like different flavors, like, you know, Azi, Audra, Corey, and all of them coming from your background, they all felt that there is a need. They, you know, there is an idea, there is a need and a gap they have to fulfill. So they went like different paths, like, you know, making their own companies, and then also like going to other tech company which is creating solutions where they are creating impact. Where Ruth and I are like working with, you know, other established companies, but still working in the innovation. It's about having the idea and then taking the idea to different places. And depending upon your idea, I think it might fit in different things. It's about like, you know, be vocal about your ideas and then surround yourself with, you know, the mentors and other people who can help you take the idea through is something I would say, you know, she can look forward to.
Yeah, thank you. And so as I, you know, you all do.
Well, there's a question.
Yay. Come on down or come on over to the microphone.
Thanks. My question is primarily geared toward Dr. Quadros. I think, you know, IPACS was started, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, out of some frustrations that you had when you were an eye doctor, and you felt that by increasing access to screening, eye screening, you would improve health outcomes in the patients that need it the most. And I am now experiencing what I'm assuming are the same frustrations that you had 30 years ago. And I know that you are still doing research on how can we improve health outcomes now that we have slightly better access. And I have a feeling that understanding that is going to be way more complicated than achieving better access. And I was wondering, based on the research you've done, the knowledge that you have, do you think the answer could be derived from big data? And if yes, what questions would you ask?
Well, that's great, because the quick answer is no. Big data is definitely a tool, just as so many innovations are a tool that you use. You put it in your toolbox and you use it when it's necessary. And really what you're bringing up is the stuff that nobody wants to study, the squishy, we call it the squishy stuff.
Soft, you know.
Yeah, okay, thank you. But honestly, you get a group of engineers together and they give you this beautiful, elegant solution. And they say, well, you know, what about the, you know, social determinants of health stuff, you know, and you know, how do you get people from point? Oh, well, you know, that's outside of our realm. We had an interesting discussion with the folks with, I think it was Livongo or the other one that's, you know, supposed to change your behavior as far as your metabolic syndrome. So, well, how is it for getting specialty referrals? And it's like, oh yeah, yeah, that's really important, but we're not gonna do it, you know? So honestly, I think that is an area, very multidisciplinary. I think it's gonna challenge a lot of people's minds. But honestly, I think that's where we need to focus if we really wanna make a big impact on health. And I think, you know, what VSP is doing with the you know, defining the healthcare deserts, that's definitely a step in the right direction. And the problem is going to be is so much more complex than that. That I'm glad that you brought up that point. Yeah. 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 Actually, my suggestion is: shall we bring primary care providers, other healthcare workers who are actually very experienced in engaging patients in their care? You know, I've been to I don't know how many little meetings around the board table, and it's like, oh, well, where's the primary care people? There are none. You know, you have the greatest minds in ophthalmology and optometry and engineering and AI, but there's nobody like really in the trenches. And I think, you know, really it's, we need to broaden beyond optometry. I think now is a good time because the healthcare environment in general is waking up to what we offer the population. I think we need to work closely with them. That's public health as well as, you know, health regular health care.
And I think another part of your question was if we had the ability to actually improve outcomes with this tech, what would we ask, or what would be the first question we ask? And that's to anybody. If we could, you know, take this technology that's been in existence for a few decades and figure out, you know, type in a question that says, how do we actually improve outcomes? You know, what would we, I guess, want to know, or what would be your burning question if there was a way to actually peer inside?
Do you mind if I just add one more thing? Sorry,
sure,
I don't dominate
sure.
this, but that's a big question,
yeah.
And an important one, and one that was existential for me in my own career, and that is, are we actually doing any good by screening? You know, so the it's a measurement question. Are we measuring the appropriate outcomes? Clinics, like I'm in my little world of retinal screening, clinics get paid for doing the retinal screening. That's great. But are they identifying the right people? Are the people actually going into treatment? So in the end, do we have solid proof that we're actually saving vision? And the problem is, even in the largest health systems, we don't have that data. You know, so with all the big data, we don't have the results.
Why is it so difficult to measure the outcome ratio?
I'm gonna repeat the question just because we're recording, so people who watch back will. So the question from the audience, thank you, was why do we not have the outcomes? What are the challenges that we face to actually assess the outcomes? What are those challenges?
Number one is we haven't even asked the question. We even haven't asked the question in our own best world, you know, maybe the best optometry school in the universe. I mean, you know, no offense to any of the other ones, but we haven't asked that question of ourselves. We don't have a systematic way of measuring, of compiling the data, the ultimate outcomes data. We don't have that. Yeah.
I mean, go ahead.
Right, I want to little bit give an example about like why it is complex, right? Think about maybe a diabetic retinopathy, like screening. Let's think about like value of that screening for every people in the chain. For example, the patient. If they actually come in, they find something, you know, they have maybe untreated PDR, now because they know they can go get treatment and then get, you know, better outcome. But if they, you know, you say that you go get treatment, but if that person doesn't go get the treatment or doesn't have access to the treatment, his eye vision is not, you know, improving. Just because you found it here, your patient outcome is not improving. It's about like closing the loop, right? But when you think about it from HMO or like, you know, the provider's one, they might be, for them, the benefit is they found it. They still will be able to like get value from it. But that's what we need to think. I'm just like giving an example of the complexity. Many a time, just because like finding something, the patient is still not getting the value out of it. It's about value for the patient, value for the doctor, value for the HMOs. It's like all coming together, right? And then the metrics are improving, like explaining, or it was explaining, it just said it's complex, you know, it's coming together, but we need to ask more questions.
I could be a little cynical, I think, in my response. I think people just don't want to put the resources into actually making the change, because I think it's going to take an enormous amount of resource. Screening and finding the problem is the issue. Fixing the problem is a tenfold issue compared to finding the issue. And to kind of use an analogy, for example, in public schools, since I work with children, they are required, if there's some service, some accessibility that the child needs in a public school, they are required to provide it. So whether it's a reading specialist, a behavioral specialist, you know, whatever, which is part of why it's been difficult to get vision therapy into public schools, which many places have tried, because if we do these screenings and find out the child has convergence insufficiency, now the school would be required to provide vision therapy to correct that, because we know from our research that convergence insufficiency can impact reading and learning ability. And so if we have these institutions that don't want to actually put their money where their mouth is, so to speak, to actually fix the problem, that's the biggest obstacle. We put a lot of time and effort and money identifying the issue, but we don't have the same resources on the ground level to actually fix the issue. And I think that's the biggest challenge. And I will fully say that this is a cynical cynical viewpoint, but no, I think realistic. So we saw a few hands go up. I'm gonna go here and then work my way around. So does some of these disparities start in the classroom? Should we be learning and teaching about social determinants of health and things of that nature?
I think that some of it can start in the classroom, of just educating clinicians about the patient journey, because I think the whole healthcare system operates under an implied assumption that patients are healthcare literate, that they have access to resources, that they're empowered, and that they can advocate for themselves. Mm. And we all know that that's not the case in many situations. So, you know, it's not uncommon for patients to fall through the cracks. And there has to be an incentive structure there that doesn't rely on the patient being their own advocate. Because if that is a baseline assumption, that there will always be patients who are not able to do that. You're seeing it in some primary care settings where the payer is incentivizing care to the point where the clinician has an incentive to help prevent disease as opposed to diagnosing and treating disease. And so when you put those incentive structures in place, then you can have that momentum guided by people who are empowered in the system and not expecting the patients to bear the brunt of that.
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, no, go ahead.
And I'm going to up-level that question a little bit to bring it back to technology. I do think that a lot of the times when companies start in the innovation process to design new technology, the question is not usually what is the accessibility problem that we're trying to face? What are the communities we're trying to reach? It's usually more like, what would be a cool thing for us to make or a cool device for us to build or something along those lines? And so those two ends don't meet, right? And so you can make accessibility a goal in that process. But to bring it back to something that I think several people mentioned earlier, it's how about having the right voices in that conversation. So if you leave a bunch of people that are not involved in the eye care community or whatever other healthcare community it is in terms of access, you have to get someone like a Ninju or a Faiz or any one of us to be in that conversation to bring that awareness and then say, okay, I guess that idea is kind of neat. How about we tweak it a little bit, because then we'll widen the demographics we can cover and bring more access to more people.
I would say as the only non-optometry school graduate, I have an outside perspective on this. You are on a cross-discipline campus and environment. And so I'm proud to say that we've had two OD interns on my team in the Innovation Center from Berkeley. And we were actually the first internship program across VSP for ODs. And so those interns had the opportunity to work on cross-discipline projects with a master's design student, an MBA, and an engineer. And so they were on a four-person team and worked on projects cross-discipline. And you know, every time that they felt like the most valuable piece of that experience was working cross-discipline and having that on their resume and being able to say, I know how to translate and work with people across disciplines and put our ideas together and think holistically. So I would just say, seek out those opportunities. Berkeley in particular, I know that right before the pandemic, I was consulting for a cannabis healthcare company, and there was a program right here called She Can, and it was so eye-opening just to hear from a like left-field part of healthcare how they were thinking about wellness, how they were thinking about consumers and retail environments, and so if you can put yourself in more places where there are different approaches to healthcare or industry or retail or patients, like that will put you in the driver's seat of understanding the sector and not just rely on, you know, professors in the environment, though we should be advocating for that. And then I'll just say one more thing. My team actually is always a judge on your various contests. So we usually have someone from VSP, from the Global Innovation Center, judging or participating. And we are always looking for more ways to put microphones in front of young ODs or students, because we have this thing on our team called the lure of the doctor. VSP values the voice of doctors very, very much. And sometimes we find there's this like lure, meaning this, you know, prototypical doctor. And so the more you all come to these hackathons and contests with, we care about sustainability, we care about technology and smart eyewear, we care about low vision, like we care about social determinants of health, that helps us say like the next generation of optometry cares about sustainability, and we should too. So keep close to that microphone, and it's never too soon to get involved in that way.
I did want to mention one more thing, and that is that things are changing, fortunately. And so, you know, there's an emergence of social impact investment. There's people that are starting to listen to exactly what you're saying, you know, trying to figure out innovations to address the social determinants of health and all that. I would say that it's good not to be afraid to knock on those doors and to, you know, bring up those issues now more than ever. In the past, you couldn't. There was nobody that was willing to listen, but now it's different. Yeah.
There's another hand in the audience. Yes. Can I have the microphone come to you? Sorry. Trying to do my best to remember, but thank you.
Hello. As someone who's been interested in public health for a long time and then hearing about difficulties in continuing research and following up on, you know, really great screening technology, I can't help but think how nice it would be to have a universal electronic health record system. And you know, I this has been discussed a lot of times. I'm curious, as with the room full of people in industry, innovation, entrepreneurial backgrounds, do you think in our lifetime, even maybe just in the eye care arena, do you think we'll ever see like a shared universal EHR that will allow us to access some better care for patients?
If you don't mind, I'm going to address that.
We're gonna pass this to the father of telemedicine.
Well, sorry. But, so interesting question, because I remember being at a conference in Paris, right? A bunch of internists. We were talking about diabetic retinopathy screening. And they said, and so we were with our little song and dance. Hey, you know, we could do this. And they go, oh, we don't need that because we have nationalized health systems. And the exams are free, the surgeries are free, we have an integrated health record, right? I said, oh, wow, okay. So is diabetes still the main cause of blindness among working age adults? Oh, yes. Is it still a big problem? Oh, yeah. So the EHR, the reason why things have evolved a certain way in the United States is partially because things may be a little dysfunctional, but that's not the only reason. It's just that a universal EHR is just a simplistic answer to a much larger problem. So I would invite you to think about what is the actual information that needs to be exchanged, you know, and maybe look for a solution that way.
I see that, like, nowadays, right, a lot of ecosystems are being built, mm-hmm. in which the information needed from one place is going into other place. It's about, like, finding what needs to go. If you are actually referring a patient to an ophthalmologist or going to retina specialist, right, what needs to go there and then what needs to go fast, right? If you find that and then solve that, I think that's going to be more, the way to go, because there are different flavors of the EHRs which you're talking about, right, for different practices. You might be, you might be seeing something in the eye, which is tortuosity of the vessels. You are like, okay, I need to send them to the PCP or even to send a specialist because I'm seeing some signs for, like, hypertension, right? For those kind of things, you would want to, like, send it to a completely different specialty. So it's about actually building the ecosystem and then also, bringing the information together. If you're asking, like, what you can do as a doctor, again, I'm going to say that be vocal about it. You know, if a referral is coming to you or, like, you are sending a referral, the information is not going, like, reach out to the, you know, the EHR or the people to say that, hey, this is not going, how can I help? And then, you know, the ideas come like this, and then only the solutions are, you know, we're going to see example of FSA, and then, you know, you develop the solution yourself. It's about, you know, the ecosystem more than about just, like, one solution for all.
Yeah, I'll piggyback on that, and I'm going to take the software business approach here. So never say never. That does seem like a very great goal. I think one thing that happens in terms of either software or hardware in the business world is that you try to avoid anti-competitive laws. And when you try to build a business and avoid anti-competitive laws, you're trying to avoid a monopoly. So if we're thinking that there's going to be, like, one consolidated ecosystem for that, an ecosystem could be fine that all integrates with each other, gives each other permissions, great. If we think it's going to be, like, just CompuLink or something that everyone uses, probably not, due to just American business structure. But we are seeing a lot more integration of these different software platforms. I use Sutter, for example, for my primary care, and there's constantly, like, a, will you give access to this other doctor you saw to have access to your records? Like, yes. And now those two systems talk to each other in a similar way. So I do think that over time there'll be more integration, and typically over time software companies tend to consolidate and merge and acquire things, so that'll probably be happening. But it might not be, like, one thing you download and that's the only thing you use.
One thing I'll say is behavior is driven by incentives. So, you know, looking at the issue that you're experiencing, you're saying, well, it would be a lot more simple for me and make my job easier if this was all one system, for example. But if you look at the incentive of the people developing that software, is it really their incentive to work towards one broad standard? Or are they better off creating a walled off ecosystem where they can protect their market share? So I think that when we're trying to understand why are things the way they are, it can be easy to think that things are the way they are because things are broken. But another perspective to look at it from is things are exactly the way they are for a specific reason. Because it makes things easier for certain people, or because people are benefiting from the status quo in a certain way. Now, that doesn't mean that you're helpless in this situation. You could provide a new incentive. So, for example, if we had a discussion and we came to a consensus as optometrists that we want to support companies that put interoperability at the forefront and actually support with our dollars those companies that are creating software that will talk to machines from different companies and bring it into one area where you can use it as the doctor, then you're essentially voting with your dollars for the solution that you want. But if you behave in a way that doesn't really incentivize a certain type of behavior, you buy instruments from this company and instruments from this company, and, you know, neither of them create software that integrates the information, and you're okay with that, then they're never going to have an incentive to do anything different.
Just to add a consumer lens to all of this, I was to kind of flipping the conversation a little bit, I was talking about this performance vision futures report that we did, and really so much of it was driven by a change in cultural values around owning your own health. So if you've ever heard of biohacking, have any of you heard of biohacking? It's really where you're trying to create data, whether that's an at-home test. There's now actually a device that you can breathe into, and it'll tell you how your metabolism is working. It's things like the Bulletproof Labs, if you've heard of them. But anyways, they're people are owning their own health. They're using the Apple Watches. These are kind of old news about wearables, an Oura Ring, and they're taking charge of their own health and their own data. And so I do think there's a force there that will eventually put some pressure on or change the consumer expectation. So even just saying in our world, like, why won't you email me my prescription? Like, that is a fundamental kind of conundrum for most consumers that we're just okay with somehow, that they can't walk out with their own data and information and actually put up. I have hilarious stories because I do what is that, undercover boss, secret shopper? And I've seen all kinds of tricks that optometry practices pull, wrong phone numbers, like all kinds of things to make sure that you don't have your own data. And this is going against what's happening in a larger scale where people are interested in biohacking, quantified self, owning their own data. So I think at some point this is going to come to a head, and you're going to have a lot of upset patients and consumers when you're telling them they can't own their own data.
Because then you could see the perspective from each lens that we have up here. Any other questions from the audience? Yes. Microphone. Thank you.
Hello. Yes. I did the same thing you just did. Mic check. Yes. 1, 2, 3. I wanted to ask, because I feel like I am personally a big consumer and listener of content, and I want to ask, how do you think you made the transition from like consuming and listening to becoming an active participant and like critical thinking and, as you said, creating space to allow for DEIB related issues? So how did you go about from like being a listener to being a participant?
Is that to anybody in particular, or
to
anyone?
Everyone.
Okay.
I mean, you could say that you always have to be a listener. That's pretty much the number one requirement for being an innovator, is just like I said about not being, it's not about being right, it's about learning and catalyzing, and you can't learn if you're not listening. And so I hire for innovators, which is actually a very difficult skill set to look for, because there's a lot of faux innovation. And so there are people who were like engineers or salespeople, and they think that that's it. And I actually have 5 questions you should ask yourself if you think you're an innovator. So you can check out my LinkedIn, it's on there. But one of them is, do you know how to create value in ambiguity? And a lot of that comes from asking good questions, listening, and being able to translate information. And so for myself, that's where I really thrived, was in articulating and connecting between the past, the current state, and the future. And being that translator, I think, brought me into a space where I was no longer kind of just a member of the team, but came to the forefront and helped other people develop that skill set as well. And then I think you can't underestimate the what kind of courage it takes to make a decision. And many people in the business world in particular don't like sticking their head out and making a decision. And so I've always kind of had the courage to do that and go beyond just challenging the status quo, poking holes, throwing rocks, but really go around it and figure out, well, what are all the components to actually change, and how can I make a decision and present information in that way that is effective? So I think those are just some things to think about if you're wanting to participate in the conversation, is just kind of do it and do it thoughtfully and think about how you can be a translator for whatever world you're in.
I think it's a great question, and I think that one key piece is getting to the point where you feel empowered to actually take that first step. So when I was a student, I was really curious about optometry and what it had to offer. So I would go to different conferences, learn about different specialties. And at the same time, I was just curious about technology in general. So I would watch a lot of YouTube videos, read articles, and hear about all the different technologies that are being developed. And I got the sense that technology in the consumer space was moving at a much faster rate than it was in the clinical space in optometry. And I saw that there was this huge divide, and I saw a risk for us to get left behind. Especially because when this technology was being brought into the eye care space, it was being brought to ophthalmology, not to optometry. You know, I would read about ARVO, the ophthalmology conference, having 100 posters about artificial intelligence, and you know, all the developers going to present and engage with that group. I did not see one single poster. And I went to 30 conferences when I was a student. I didn't see a single poster about artificial intelligence. And so, you know, I felt that I had a responsibility to at least try to get the word out there. So my first action into getting involved was to write articles, pretty much just summarizing the things that, you know, the content that I had absorbed. And then after a while, it just kind of dawned on me and just thought to myself, okay, at the end of my career, do I want to think of myself as someone who was a spectator and who was seeing this happen and had an opportunity to get on the court and play? Or was I satisfied with just being at the stands and, you know, being a consumer and just spectating? So I will say one of the things that really did help me take that step is also just the resources that are out there and the mentors that I've had. So, you know, there's a lot of sources for empowerment. You guys have an institution here where you have a lot of great faculty and a lot of great resources, and some of these resources you won't have the day after you graduate in the same way. So I would say take advantage of the opportunities that you have now. Find ways to empower yourself, whether it's getting new knowledge, building a network, and then from there, you'll see the specific path for yourself.
And that kind of makes me want to ask, what is causing the low velocity of innovation in eye care? Because I'm just astonished, like surprised, but not surprised to hear that, you know, at ARVO, you see hundreds of posters about AI and zero at optometry conferences. So why are we so late to get on the bandwagon? Why do you think we're behind the eight ball? Or not behind the eight ball, that's the opposite analogy. See, I'm getting my analogies. Why are we so far behind?
I'll take a stab at that first. So I think there's just a lot of fear, right? So like think of the last time you either purchased or downloaded a new piece of tech. You bought a Peloton bike, you bought a new phone, you got your first laptop. There's a lot of excitement around that. You probably like came home from the store grinning ear to ear. But then if you think about something you've done in optometry that's technology-based, like you're looking for glasses online, or you're thinking about telemedicine exams, or you're looking at apps that might purport to do some sort of diagnostic test, that's like a really different feeling, right? There's a lot of visceral reaction to like, oh, I don't know how I feel about this. And so I think a lot of the problem here is it's a vicious cycle of lack of response in the market. So when a lot of these companies that make tools or do research put it out there, if no one picks it up, that signals back to them to stop doing it. So if they put out like a new OCT or something like that and nobody buys it, or if telemedicine has no customers, the signal back is therefore going to be, nobody wants this, so we're not gonna make it any better for the future. We're not gonna spend any time on this. So, you know, I think that level of fear is a main factor. I would just encourage people to keep an open mind and just try things, make up your own mind for yourself. Not everything's gonna be good, but it definitely starts with like making up your own opinion about these things.
I just want to second that, you know, what Faiz said, feeling empowered, because you do have the power. And I think optometrists often don't have enough of that, you know. And you need to make the space for yourself to be able to do it, to do the innovations. But yeah, no, everybody in this room has a really, you know, clear experience with eye care, and it's just a matter of thinking, yes, you can make those changes and pursue that path. The only other thing, the question I always ask in the digital health rotation is, will you be using phoropters in 10 years? And a lot of people say, of course, why? If it's not broken, why fix it? And broken is kind of a subjective opinion. You know, I would say maybe there's a lot of things wrong with the way that we've been doing it for the last 100 years. And it would take some analysis, as our panel here was saying, you know, really kind of pick at it and really think is this really the best that it could be?
I will also just add that historically there has been a high barrier to entry. So, you know, thinking that you want to create some type of innovation and then trying to get into the same space as a company like Carl Zeiss, like, that's going to be kind of tough, you know, to compete in that same space. And that's also kind of part of the reason why certain areas haven't seen innovation, because maybe the potential for revenue from, say, solving this problem doesn't really get the established companies excited. You know, some company executives, you know, if they look at an idea and they say, well, if it's not going to make $50 million in 5 years' time, I'm not interested. Some companies won't, you know, some people won't even get out of bed if there's not $10 million, you know, of potential in that certain area. And so that is, in a way, a bad thing, because there are people who kind of go overlooked, but it's not anything intentional, because those companies have to operate at that scale. When you look at the facilities and, you know, the people with expertise that they have, they just have, you know, a lot of expenses, so they need to kind of essentially have an opportunity to hit a home run, financially speaking. But then that creates a lot of room for someone who is facing that problem on the ground level as a clinician who is seeing this problem with patients, and can be, you know, someone that can catalyze that opportunity. So, you know, I think that's kind of an important thing, is as you're going through your journey, look at the pain points that you experience personally, and look at the pain points that your patients experience. And then you're going to see the opportunities to help. So the vast majority of people think that, you know, business succeed because of ideas. I think that the best businesses actually succeed because they identify the right problems. If you start with the problem, you can always iterate on the idea. And I'm not sure if this is like misattributed to Albert Einstein, but I believe I read a quote about him saying, if I had an hour to solve a problem, I would spend 50 minutes thinking about the problem and 10 minutes thinking about the solution. So I would say you're extremely empowered right now as far as understanding all the different little problems that exist in the eye care system, because you're not ingrained in the way eye care has been done for the past 40 years. You have a fresh set of eyes. You can walk into a situation. If something seems like, you know, this should not be this hard, then that's an opportunity for you to make a change.
So to add the one more flavor to it, when we're thinking about the healthcare space itself, and specifically eye care, like all the healthcare, right? We are working in a regulated space. So anything which is basically, you know, getting released as a technology, if it needs to come into healthcare to provide any clinical benefit, that goes through a specific process. And we have, you know, regulatory agencies like FDA, and then processes like MDR for EU, which, you know, the, both the startups and then the big companies have to actually go through. And also there is another piece of solution, the whole, you know, conundrum, which I'm not sure how much is covered in the curriculum. It's called reimbursement. you know, I think you guys will deal with it a lot, I think, when you practice, but also, you know, you have to like think of it like fully when you're thinking about the value that your solution is going to provide. Because of this regulated industry with, you know, the reimbursement and other things like coming, you know, it's all good things, I wouldn't say bad things, but all evolve at like different speeds, right? So that also is something which causes, or at least it actually gives the perception that, you know, the underlying innovation, it is slow.
Yeah. Any other questions from the audience? I think I'll ask just one wrap-up question. What do you think folks in the audience should think about and do concerning tech, healthcare, and making sure there's equity infused in the bridging of those two worlds?
All right, I'll start. You should definitely go and read the Futurist reports so that you're equipped with the story and the indicators around technology and innovation and understand the solutions out there. I think it's been brought up a few times. Innovation is not about the idea. Ideas are a dime a dozen. If someone's like, I can't tell you my idea, like they're definitely not from the real kind of tech and innovation world, because we all know it's about actually operationalizing it, and that's where the difficulty is. So I would say if you can get yourself the information, if you can get into the trenches of where experiments are happening, where new ideas are being operationalized, When it comes to the kind of diversity and equity piece, I would really encourage everyone to, as wonderful as the Bay Area is, consider that this is a career that can bring you anywhere in the country or world, and take this opportunity to go and open your mind in another space. It's so important to get perspective. I know I value my time in New Orleans. I have it in my bio that it helped me get into the trenches of a place that was going through reinvention after Hurricane Katrina. And to see this kind of rebirth and the way that people had to pivot their behavior from being like owning a business or running a business to starting a business was very different. And so when I think about healthcare deserts, you have an opportunity to go to a place like Montana or Oregon and make a difference in people's lives versus just competing in an oversaturated market, and get yourself perspective, and you can always come back or always move somewhere else. So I would really think deeply about how you can give yourself some perspective in life and in your industry and career.
My challenge to the audience, I think, would be, like I was starting to say before, just try something new. Maybe make a cadence for yourself. Like once a month, you try one new piece of eye care technology. Maybe it's an instrument in the clinic that you're not super familiar with, or at someone else's clinic. Maybe you download an app for eye care that you've never seen before. You go look at some other YouTube videos about a technology you're not familiar with. I think that has twofold. Number one, the first benefit is that you get more familiar with what's out there, and then you can provide your patients more solutions. And then number two, it can spark ideas for you, so that how you can bring more access to more people. Because if you know what technologies are out there, you can identify more solutions and connect threads for people, like, oh, well, you know what? I heard about this great app that changes colors on your phone so that people with color deficiencies can see things more clearly. Like, if you didn't know that existed or not, like, you're not gonna be able to make that recommendation. So try something new, maybe once a month.
Any other advice for the audience?
Yeah. So, you know, I would say, as far as having an interest in promoting diversity and inclusion, you guys already have that. You know, you wouldn't be here if you didn't care. So, you know, your values are already there. And I would say that technology can be really a great tool for you to amplify the impact that you can personally make. And for me, it was a process of just kind of thinking about, you know, different paths that I can take and what kind of impact those could have. So if I was only seeing patients, I can measure how many patients I see in a year, how many years I want to practice. You know, that's the number of lives that I can impact, say, in that modality. If I went to a different modality that could help amplify that by 100 times, 1,000 times, 10,000 times, then, you know, that's something that automatically garnered my interest, because I want, you know, the next 30 years of my career to not just be a job to pay bills. I want it to be something that I feel rewarded and fulfilled, that I did something of significance. And so technology is a tool to help you amplify whatever positive impact that you want to make in the world. And, you know, that's kind of where I started kind of my journey from. And then if you do end up being interested in technology, I would say satisfy your curiosities, find different places to get information, different places to meet people who are like-minded and who can help kind of cultivate that passion within you. Being around like-minded people is such a huge thing. And for me, that was going to hackathons and going to entrepreneurship conferences. We don't have that same ecosystem in optometry per se right now, but that doesn't have to be an obstacle for you. You can still find people who are like-minded. You have the internet now, you have social media. There's really no shortage of places to get inspiration and to get practical knowledge on how to get started. So I would say you are better prepared than anyone before you ever in optometry. So don't think less of yourself. Understand that you have a unique opportunity in front of you, and that if you do want to make that impact, there are tons of resources there for you.
And can I just add like one footnote to that? Being an OD is such a superpower, where people kind of look at you at like a wild animal in these situations. They don't know how to deal with you. They're like, oh, you're a doctor, and you can kind of talk to me about technology or inclusion. It's such an incredible like secret skill that you don't know that you have. So just put yourself in those situations.
Say that, you know, 2 points regarding to what Corey said. Ask yourself, like, why not? Get into this habit of asking why not. If you see something not working, or if you see like a sector being excluded in the access, like always ask why not. That is going to make you go through the next steps, and then have courage to follow through is something. The final thing I want to leave you with is seek opportunities and mentors. For me, mentor is something who is like, who played very, very essential part in my career, because sometimes there are so much outside like what you know. Talking to other people who have gone through like what you want to, or you know, from a different perspective is like very important. Because I do have optometrists in my team. Sometimes when I talk to them, they are always like, oh, if I come to industry, do I have to stop practicing? Like, no, many of the optometrists in the industry, they practice for 1 or 2 days, and then they work in industry for the rest of the days. So it's about, you know, you don't have to like leave patient care at all. Like, you know, if you want to go and do something different, you can do both. It's about like seeking the opportunities. And then mentors who can get you to the opportunities, also something going to be helpful.
And I'll just end up saying that, you know, you say that innovation's slow. I don't see it that way. You know, when I look back on how it was when I got out of school, it's just a completely different profession. And it's only happening faster now. So hold on to your seats. Keep an open mind. It's really a great time to be an optometrist. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you to the panelists so much for joining us today. Thank you, audience members, for coming and asking your great questions. This concludes our symposium. Please, again, help yourself to refreshments in the back, and there's a whole slew of refreshments out in the lobby area. So thank you again, and good night. Good evening.